Every story has a beginning and an ending. Usually, we prefer happy endings over tragic ones. In the beginning of the world, God created the heavens and the earth. He also created Adam and Eve in His image. The man and the woman were both happy in their Eden home. But later they disobeyed God. And this disobedience God punished by sending them out of the Garden of Eden. But the story did not end there. In Genesis 3:15, God tells the serpent, also known as Satan, "I will cause hostility between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." In other words, Satan would eventually receive a wound which would cause his death. The deliverer, God's own son, born as the baby Jesus, would be wounded on the cross in conflict with Satan, but his wound would not be a lasting one.
Matthew 1:20-23. In the fullness of time, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph, son of David, in a dream. The angel said, "Do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. "Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us." And in the fullness of time, Mary gave birth to her first child, a son. 8 days later, when the baby was circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name given him by the angel even before he was conceived. At that time, there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. He was righteous and devout and was eagerly waiting for the Messiah to come. The Holy Spirit was upon him and had revealed to him that he would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. That day, the Spirit led him to the temple. So when Mary and Joseph came to present the baby Jesus to the Lord as the law required, Simeon was there. He took the child in his arms and praised God, as recorded in chapter 2 of Luke, verses 29-32. He said, "Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace, as you have promised. I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all people. He is a light to reveal God to the nations, and he is the glory of your people."
Immediately after his baptism, Jesus went up into the wilderness to get ready for his time of ministry. He fasted and prayed during this time so that he would be spiritually strong and able to resist any temptation by the devil. When Jesus was the weakest, the devil came to him with three different trials. The entire story is found in Matthew 4, verses 2 through 11. And this first trial would be found in verses 2 through 4. For 40 days and 40 nights, he fasted and became very hungry. During that time, the devil came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become loaves of bread." But Jesus told him, "No. The scriptures say, people do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." The devil tried to get Jesus to do what he wanted, and he started with appetite. This was the same kind of temptation he used in the Garden of Eden on Adam and Eve. With Jesus, however, it did not work, and it doesn't have to work with us. We can ask God to help us with just such a problem. In the next trial, the devil tried to get Jesus to risk his life by jumping off the highest point of the temple, Matthew 4, verses 5 through 7. Then the devil took him to the holy city, Jerusalem, to the highest point of the temple and said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off, For the scriptures say, he will order his angels to protect you, and they will hold you up with their hands, so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. Jesus responded, the scriptures also say, you must not test the Lord your God. Jesus knew that if he did anything the devil suggested, he would seem to be friends with him. Isn't it the same for us? God has given us in the Bible all the information we need to avoid troubles in life. When we step outside those guidelines, we also step away from his protection. In the third and final trial, the devil finally got around to what he wanted all along. He wanted Jesus to worship him. He wants the same thing from us. Matthew 4, verses 8 through 11. Next, the devil took him to the peak of a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. I will give it all to you, he said, if you will kneel down and worship me. Get out of here, Satan, Jesus told him, for the scriptures say, you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil went away, and angels came and took care of Jesus. We don't have to fear any problems in life if we just ask God to help us through them. Jesus endured these trials so that, just as with baptism, we would have an example of the power of God in every situation, to know that God is with us in all things. And if God is with us, who can be against us? After Jesus had ministered for 3.5 years, the Jewish religious leaders finally found a way to get rid of him. They brought him to the Roman governor, Pilate, and accused him of setting himself up as king of the Jews. Because of the civil unrest and because he was being pressured by the top religious authorities, Pilate finally agreed to allow Jesus to be crucified to gratify the Jewish leaders, even though he had said more than once that he found Jesus to be innocent. When Jesus died, the Roman centurion on duty at the cross acknowledged in Mark 15, verse 39, truly this man was the Son of God. But thankfully, the story does not end here. Now on the first day of the week, after the Sabbath had passed, three of Jesus' followers went to the tomb to care for his body. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were afraid. But he said to them, do not be afraid. You look for Jesus of Nazareth. He was crucified, and he is risen. Mark 16, verses 5 and 6. After Jesus' resurrection, he spent 40 days with his friends. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, that Jesus was then taken up and a cloud received him out of their sight. As they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. Men of Galilee, they said, why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go. When Jesus was on the earth, his friends could have confidence in what he said. They could have hope for the future. We also can have this hope, this confidence, that just as Jesus came as a little baby at the perfect time so long ago, he will also come again just as he has promised. And we need to be ready when Jesus does come. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 9 through 11, Peter encourages us to get ready because the Lord does not want any to be lost. The Lord isn't really being slow about his promise, as some people think. No, he is being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. But the day of the Lord will come as unexpectedly as a thief. Then the heavens will pass away with a terrible noise, and the very elements themselves will disappear in fire, and the earth and everything on it will be burned up. Since everything around us is going to be destroyed like this, what holy and godly lives you should live, looking forward to the day of God and hurrying it along. And my friends, I want to reemphasize what we just read. that the Lord is being patient for our sakes. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. Listen to these encouraging words from Jesus himself in Revelation chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. "Look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in, and we will share a meal together as friends. Those who are victorious will sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat with my Father on his throne." Amen. If for the first time it is your desire to learn more about God's love for you, or if you are already a believer and realize that you need to make some changes so that you can be ready to meet Jesus when he comes, then pray with me the following prayer. Father God, thank you for loving me. Forgive me for all my wrongs that may have hurt our relationship. Help me to know the truth about you and your Son Jesus. Amen. May God bless you and care for you as you search for him. Jeremiah 29:13 says, "And you will seek me and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart."